See, this of you all, because I have you in my heart. You see that? What he had for the Thessalonians, he had for the Philippians too. He said, I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my bonds and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, ye all are partakers of my grace. For God is my record, is my witness, how greatly I long after you all in the bowels of Jesus Christ. Well, that is something from Paul the Apostle here. His commitment to help the Thessalonians didn't diminish his commitment to help the Philippians. There are some people that are one-sided in their love. If there are maybe about 2, 3, 4, 5 locations for them to help or to lift up or to encourage or to enlighten or to kind of affirm and strengthen, then they concentrate just on one. And they're only in Thessalonica all the time, And they're praying for Thessalonica all the time. But Paul the Apostle said, Philippians, you're in my heart too. Philippians, I want to visit you. Philippians, I want you to develop in the Lord too. And that is what should be the heart of the overseer and the heart of the local government pastor and the heart of the people that have overseeing responsibility over many locations. You go to all those places, not just Thessalonica alone. And it says in verse 9, and this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in the knowledge and in all judgment. We're looking at Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, reading from verse 1. Colossians chapter 2. This apostle, with affection, affection for every church, affection for all the locations where the Lord had sent him to minister. Colossians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 1. For I would that he knew what great conflict I have for you, and for them at Laodicea, and for many that have not seen my face in the Lord. I see here Paul the Apostle is even talking to these people. He said, you have not seen my face. I wasn't the one that brought you to the Lord, but I've heard of you. I've heard about your faith. I've heard about your conversion. I've heard about your coming to know the Lord. I've heard about the church they have planted and the church that is growing and strengthening over there. And I'm longing to even come unto you. Can you think about this for your personal life, your personal ministry? That it is not just Thessalonica alone that you are saying, oh, I'm sorry, Thessalonians, I've not been with you. You ought to be sorry too. You have not been in Philippi. You ought to be sorry too. You have not been in Colossae. He said, I'm longing after you, desiring to see you. As much as I want to see other people, even the people in Laodicea as well, in verse 2, that their heart might be comforted, being knit together, united together, joined together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance and understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and to the Father and of Christ. So then he tells us that he has that same passion. Colossians chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 12. Well, I mean here that it wasn't Paul the Apostle alone. There were all the ministers too that had the same passion. Isn't that wonderful that the co-laborers of Paul the Apostle had the same heart, the same affection, the same passion as Paul the Apostle? And wouldn't it be wonderful if all the workers will have the same heart and the same passion, the same affection with their leader? That is, all the people in the district, they have the same desire, the same passion, the same interest, the same consecration as the coordinator. That all the surrenders and all the coordinators will have the same passion, the same desire, the same affection for the church of the living God as the group coordinator has. And all the leaders and all the ministers in the region will have the same passion, the same pursuit as the region overseer has. And it should not just be the region overseer alone, running here and there and reaching this and touching this and getting that and planting that and raising up that, edifying this one. But we all have the same heart. And if all the region overseers will have the same passion, the same affection, the same desire, the same pursuit, the same consecration as the state overseers and the national overseers. And here is what we find here. Look at this in chapter 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ. This is not just Paul alone now. Some people say, okay, that's okay for Paul. We understand Paul, his vision, his passion, his affection, his commitment, his consecration. Not only Paul, the co-laborers too, the fellow servants too, The people that got the gospel through Paul the apostle, and then they went out with the same zeal. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluted you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that ye may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. For I bear him record that he hath a great zeal for you. Look at this. And for them that are in Laodicea and them in Hierapolis. It's telling us that these ministers of God in the Bible, in Bible days, they were not just passionate about one city. They were not just passionate about one location. They were not just passionate about one state. Not just passionate about one region. They were passionate about other church locations too. And that's a great, great lesson for you and for me. Our passion to help the church, raise the church, develop the church, strengthen the church, build the church will not just be for one location. It will be for all the locations that the Lord has put under our leadership and also our supervision. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. Acts chapter 20. I will see the burning passion and the burning pursuit of Paul the Apostle coming out. And here is another place now. Again, I'm just trying to emphasize to you that Paul the Apostle, his interest was not just in one solitary location, Thessalonica. And you find him here now. This is, we're looking at Ephesus now. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 from verse 17. And from Miletus, he sent to Ephesus, and he called the elders of the church. Have you seen Paul the Apostle? Thessalonica, yes, my passion, my affection is for you. Philippi, yes, my passion is for you. Colossae, my passion, my desire to get you developed and to grow. All that is for you. And the Laodiceans, my heart is with you. I want to be there to come and be of help to you. And then now in Ephesus, I want to be there too. It's opening your eyes to see that you ought to concentrate on all the areas of ministry the Lord has given you. Have you noticed that there are some people in the church and they only concentrate on one area? As fellowship is there, no, that's not my concern. I mean, this other area, and you know, evangelism is there, so is that. No, that's not my part. I'm just in this area, and then there's another thing that is being done in the church to get commerce to know the Lord. No, that's not my heart. This is my area. Paul the Apostle is saying, oh yes, I love the Thessalonians. I even want to impart my very soul unto them. But I love the Philippians too. I love the Colossians too. I love the Laodiceans too. And I love the people in Ephesus too. Love everyone. And be willing to stretch yourself, distribute your time, and give yourself to the growth of the church in all the locations where the Lord has given us opportunity to be able to touch the people over there. We're looking at verse 18, and when they were come from all those places, from Ephesus, it says, he said unto them, you know, from the first day that I came into Asia, after the manner that I have been with you at all seasons, serving the Lord with all humility of mind, and with many tears and temptations and trials which befell me by the lying in wait of the Jews, how I kept nothing back that was profitable unto you, but I've showed you and I've taught you publicly and from house to house. You understand what that means? Publicly, mass evangelism, I was there. Publicly, open air evangelism, I was there. Publicly, that open air campaign, I was there. And then from house to house, I was there. That's what I'm telling you. Paul the Apostle, he just stretched himself out, distributed his time, and then he made use of all means to be able to reach everybody. When it's mass evangelism, yes, I'm there. When it's personal evangelism, house to house evangelism, touching people one by one, I am there as well. And then he tells us in verse 19, he says, serving the Lord with all humility of mind and with many tears and temptations. And then he goes on, he says in verse 21, testifying both to the Jew and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that the same passion the Lord will give to us. Look at verse 26, it says, wherefore I take you to record this day that I'm pure from the blood of all men. I was telling the people at Ephesus, you could have told them in Philippi too. The same thing. He could have told them the same thing to in Laodicea. He could have told them the same thing in Colossus. He could have told them the same thing in Thessalonica. Because he just gave everything his God to every place and everywhere that he went. And you should be able to say the same thing. Certainly, if you have about 5 children, you'll not be a good father. If all you do is, I'm educating the first one, is the important one, is the central one, is the most essential of the children. And then all the other children are not going to school. And then you're training 1 out of 5. And then you say, hey, daddy, how about these 4 children? You know, I just love this child, Thessalonica, and I'm putting all my heart, all my effort, and everything I've got onto just that one. That's not a good father. And Paul was not like that. Not sectional. The same thing. All the people that are looking up to you, go everywhere. Teach the word. Preach the word. Reach the churches. Develop them. And show that your interest is not in just one location. Reach everywhere. I pray God will give us wisdom. Then it says in verse 27, for I have not shown to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take it therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. All the flock, you understand that? As a state overseer, all the flock in all the regions. As a state overseer, all the flock in all the local governments. Move on, move around, go around. You touch this local government, touch that region, and touch that other region. Now that somebody is a state overseer for 5 years, and he's been only going to one region for those 5 years, and all the other regions have never seen him. Paul the Apostle said, the Holy Ghost has made you overseers over all the flock, and therefore you'll touch them, reach them, and go to them, and teach them the word of God. He's made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his blood. I pray God will use us. We're looking at 2 John verse 12. 2 John has only one chapter. 2 John, that one chapter, verse 12. Having many things to write unto you, I would not write with paper and ink, but I trust to come unto you and speak face to face, that our joy may be full. Here is John. You know, it's the same thing that all these other ministers had. Paul, the same thing. Timothy, the same thing. Silas, the same thing. Peter, the same thing. And then we have John here, the beloved, the same thing. And he says, I could have written to you, I could have sent a message to you by writing, but I want to see you face to face so that I will impart it to you. That he didn't say that your joy may be full. He said that our joy may be full. When I'm able to touch you and you are able to hear the message directly, and I see that your life is moving on, saved and sanctified and strengthened and sustained by the power of the word, then your joy is full and my joy is full as well. I pray God will do it through us in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number 2 now, unrelenting adversary against progress in the church. Unrelenting adversary against the progress of the church. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. I'm reading from verse 18. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're looking at verse 18. Wherefore, we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. He was talking to the Thessalonian believers, and he said, here is the pattern of ministry. And here is the progress of ministry. Here is the way we should do ministry. It says over here, we would have come unto you. When you have converts, we should have gone unto them. When you have people in the house fellowship, you should have gone unto them. When you have a region under your leadership, you should have gone unto them. You know, there are some people that wait and they say, well, I'm here, I'm available. They know that I'm here, I'm their pastor, I'm their leader, I'm their overseer. If they have need and they recognize my value and my gift, they will come unto me. Paul the Apostle said, no. He says, wherefore we, Paul and Silas and Timotheus, we would have come unto you. He says now, even me in particular, even I, Paul, once and again, not just once, but once and again, once and again, once and again. That means then if you're a leader over the household of faith, you see them once and again. You touch their lives once and again. You teach them once and again. You go to them to see them, minister to them directly once and again. Even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. We'll talk about that later. We're looking at why were they to go there? And why were they to reach those terminals? Why was he saying, I wanted to come? Or Timothy and Silas. And we would have reached you once and again. Again, let's think about our state of affairs. It just happens today that we're studying about Paul, the apostle, happened to be an overseer over the church in Philippi, over the church in Colossae, over the church, also in Ephesus, over the church, also in Thessalonica, over the church in Galatia. And then you'll see that he touched all of them. He wasn't just talking about the Thessalonian believers. He was an all-around person. And if you are an overseer, this is what we should do. That's why we're overseers. Overseers, seeing over all those people. And what was he wanting to do? Number one, to evangelize the sinners. Evangelize. That's number one, the thing that was to do. And this is what should be in our heart, in our mind, to evangelize. Number two is to establish the converts, to establish that these converts have come to know the Lord by your evangelism. And now you are going from place to place and you want to establish them. Number three is to enlighten them, enlighten the ignorant. And you know, that's why it says, I will not have you to be ignorant concerning the people that are falling asleep, that you sorrow not as they that have no hope. Because as the ministers move around, as the overseers move around, as the apostles moved around, it was to evangelize, number one. Number two is to establish. Number three is to enlighten the ignorant. Number four is to edify the church. And so as we move around and we say, I'm visiting Thessalonica today, I'm visiting Philippi the other week, I'm visiting Colossae the other time, I'm going to edify the church, build it up, raise it up, make them strong, strong in conviction and strong in the Lord. Not only that, number five is to empower the weak, enable the weak. That the people that are weak and their knees are weak and their hearts are weak and their backbones are weak and do not have any conviction, empower them. Number six is to equip the workers and the ministers so that after you have left, because you know Paul the apostle with all these other ministers, Silas and Timothy, they were not living in Thessalonica, and therefore when they were there, they must kind of equip those workers there, and they must develop those workers there, strengthen those workers there, so that after they have gone, they will be able to continue the work. And then number seven is to enlist and to engage, enroll them in the work. After you have trained them up and after you have shown them what they ought to do, enroll them, enlist them, engage them. Remember, as we move around, as we supervise, as we are overseers over states and over regions, and we're not just concentrating on Thessalonica alone, and we're moving from place to place, here is what we do. Number one, evangelize. Number two, you establish. Number three, you enlighten. Number four, you edify. Number five, you empower. Number six, you equip. And then number seven, you engage, you enlist. I pray God will help us to do it in Jesus' name. And let me come to, before I go to these other verses, let's look at this first.